name is Braden MacLeod, and this is my brother.
Hi, I'm Connor MacLeod.
And today, we welcome you to the worship service.
Hey, I was supposed to say that.
No, I was. Anyway, welcome.
Welcome.
The city on the hill, said one old man to the other, it once shine bright and it would be shining still, but they all started turning on each other. You see, the poets thought the dancers were shallow, and the soldiers thought the poets were weak. And the elders saw the young ones as foolish, and the rich man never heard the poor man speak. And one by one they ran away with their made-up minds to leave it all behind. And the light began to fade in the city on the hill, the city on the hill. Each one thought that they knew better, but they were different by design. Instead of standing strong together, they let their differences divide. And one by one, they ran away with their made-up minds to leave it all behind. And the light began to fade in the city on the hill, city on the hill. And the world is searching still. But it was the rhythm of the dancers that gave the poets life. It was the spirit of the poets that gave the soldiers strength to fight. It was the fire of the young ones. It was the wisdom of the old. It was the story of the poor man that made it to be told. It is the rhythm of the dancers that gives the poets life. It is the spirit of the poets that gives the soldiers strength to fight. It is the fire of the young ones. It is the wisdom of the old. It is the story of the poor man that's meaning to be told. One by one will we run away with our made-up minds to leave it all behind. As the light begins to fade in the city on the hill, one by one will we run away with our made-up minds to leave it all behind. As the light begins to fade in the city on the hill, the city on the hill. Father's calling still, come home to the city on the hill, come home.
Hi everyone, my name is Rebecca Rogers, and this week's scripture is from Matthew 28, verses 16 to 20, the Great Commission. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." This is the word of the Lord. Amen.
Sometimes our future, it's just chosen for us. It's nothing we ever intended or we would even dream of. It just takes us by surprise. I was there. I saw it with my own two eyes. I saw Jesus getting baptized by John the Baptist. I saw him heal that blind man. He cast demons out of people. And that little girl, he raised that little girl from the dead. I talked with Mary when she came back from an empty tomb. And I was there that night that Peter wanted to replace Judas. And it came down to two people, Barsabbas and myself. And we would cast lots to decide. I was devoted. There's no question about that. I trailed him wherever he went. I watched his every move. But this, God would either call me or he wouldn't call me. Either way, I knew I would never be the same man again. And then suddenly, it was me. God chose me to be one of the 12. Amazing. And it was almost like a whisper. Sometimes your future is just chosen for you. And I knew what I had to do. The answer was clear. I would not just watch him. I wouldn't just trail him. I will follow him. With complete abandon, I will trust him completely. I will go wherever he goes. I will love God. And I will love others. And I will lead.
Well, as the Gospel of Matthew comes to a conclusion on here in the 28th chapter, we've read that the disciples have gone on ahead to Galilee, just as Jesus had directed them. And it's important to note that they came that far by faith alone, believing in what the women had told them, the ones who had met the risen Christ that Easter Sunday morning at the tomb, and had been told by the Christ to go and tell the disciples all that they had heard, to not be afraid, and to go on ahead and meet Jesus in the Galilee. You can almost picture now, at the end of this gospel, these 11 disciples who have all clustered together. They finally see Jesus, and their hearts must be bursting with love. As they fall down on their knees and they at his feet, and they worship him with all sincerity. But it mixed in with that, the scripture says that some doubted. Kind of a strange place for doubt, wouldn't you say? I You know, I found that the word some actually doesn't occur in the original Greek text of what we read this morning. Plus, the small little Greek word that is translated as but in this particular instance, it can also be interpreted as the word and. So then this verse might be able to be read this way. And seeing him, they worshiped and they doubted. Not some doubted, they all doubted. To me, that sounds even stranger than what I just talked about. I mean, how can you worship and doubt at the same time? And truthfully, I wondered about that, and so I did a study, and I came across a book called Loving Jesus, and the author was a theologian by the name of Mark Allen Powell, who also wondered about this particular moment at the end of Matthew's gospel. So he asked a biblical translator and received the following response from him. And it says, basically said, the translator said, the verse wouldn't make any sense any other way. No one, he says, can worship and doubt at the same time. So Powell then invited this translator to his Lutheran church. Apparently, according to Powell, they do that all the time. Now, I would doubt, I would also add that doubt is probably a fixture in many churches. And I know I've come across a few in the United Methodist Church. Now, but reading that, what I wondered was, what's the source of their doubt that they're expressing? After all, they did travel, as I said, by faith to this location in the Galilee, from Jerusalem to get the Galilee. So that alone, to me, speaks volumes of faith about Jesus and his resurrection, right? Right? So that can't be what they're doubting, could it be? I mean, let's face it, though, if you've read all of Matthew's gospel or any of the gospels, you have to know that the disciples exhibited doubt throughout the whole gospel. In fact, this whole faith thing for them always seemed that doubt was within arm's length away from them. You just need to go back two chapters to chapter 26, when Jesus was arrested, and I believe the main reason why nearly all of them ran away at that moment was because they doubted that Jesus was who he claimed to be. But now they've come in faith to meet the risen Christ in front of them, and instead of asking questions to prove who he is, they fall to their knees and they worship. That's because, church, resurrection will cure almost every doubt you have about Jesus. See, that's why I don't think the point that Matthew's making here in this gospel is he's speaking about their lack of faith in Jesus. It's more likely he's writing about their own self-doubts. And that's because the word doubt used here is also used earlier on again in Matthew's gospel, particularly in chapter 14, when Peter steps out of the boat at the invitation of Jesus to walk on water. And Peter begins to walk on water, and the moment he realizes he's walking on water, he suddenly realizes he's doing exactly what Jesus is doing. And in that split second, he goes from walking on water to treading water to needing to be rescued from drowning. And after being rescued from that moment, Jesus asked Peter, "Why did you doubt?" It's the same word. And then later on in gospel, in the chapter of 17 of Matthew's gospel, beginning at verse 14, a father comes to the disciples, actually comes to Jesus, begging him to heal his son from the seizures he's been afflicted with. And this was after the father had already brought the child to the disciples, who were unable to cure the boy, which then Jesus, rather in exasperating, replies to them, unbelieving and perverse generation, how long shall I stay with you? How long should I put up with you? Bring the boy to me. And then Jesus heals the boy. Now, afterwards, in verse 19, the disciples privately come up to Jesus and they ask why they were unable to help. And Jesus replies by saying, it's because you had so little faith. Let me give you a little background before I go much further in the sermon about what it meant to be a rabbi or called by a rabbi to come follow him. For a rabbi to do so, they basically were seeing in that individual they were calling to follow them, that that individual one day would have the ability to do exactly what the rabbi was able to do. Meaning that when Jesus called these particular disciples, he saw in them the potential to do what he did. So as Jesus' earthly ministry is coming to an end, he reminds these doubting disciples that all authority in heaven and in earth that he has, they now have access to. And therefore, to go make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them everything that he has taught them and everything that he has commanded them. And he then promises at the end, surely I will be with you till the end of the age. Now, Jesus is simply telling these disciples, now is the time for you to step up. Now is the time for you to take control and let nothing stop you, especially your doubt. Let nothing interfere with your ability to carry out Jesus' ministry that some might even reject because they rejected Jesus. So when you stop and you gather all of that in, you know, you come to the conclusion, what Jesus is leaving with these men, it's a lot of work. It's a huge responsibility to carry on this ministry. And that's why I don't think these disciples are lacking faith in Jesus. No, it's more about them believing in their own potential to be able to do what Jesus said they should be able to do, no matter how intimidating the task is ahead of them. The caveat being this. You know, having a little bit of doubt about yourself isn't a bad thing. You know, actually, this doubt that the disciples are showing in this moment put them in a perfect place to be a disciple. See, because with that, they were less likely to run on ahead of the Holy Spirit. See, my greatest worry as a pastor is that when I believe God is speaking to me, if I'm allowed to have a great worry, is it merely my voice at times that I'm hearing? And that piece of doubt, though, causes me to proceed cautiously. So having some doubt, faith-wise, isn't necessarily bad. But you got to use your faith in order to energize or relieve yourself of your doubt. You have to do all that while seeking God's will. See, my experience is if it's God who is truly speaking, you'll know. The doors you never imagined would open will open, and you'll find yourself in a place you never dreamed of. But too much, you know, doubt can destroy a person's ability to step out in faith. There are plenty of Christian skeptics who I've met over the course of my life who let their doubt keep them firmly in place. You know, they'll say things, well, like, if I'm not 100% sure it's God, you know, calling, I'm not going to do anything. The point is, as I said earlier, the only way to overcome doubt is by using your faith. So you can have doubts if you want. You can have doubts about yourself, but don't let them stop you from working with Jesus. You know, Jesus saw the potential in these disciples to do even what he had done. And yet, a few of them might have been thinking all along, really? You know, really? He's sending us or me into the world? But because of that doubt, you see, they were committed to staying with one another, to support one another, and pray with one another, sharing all of their resources together. And with all that power, these doubting disciples became world changers, and the church thrived and grew. You know, I'd be willing to bet, if I was not a United Methodist, I'd be willing to bet, but if I could go back in time, I believe the first words out of the mouths of these disciples after Jesus spoke would be the same. Who, me? Are you talking to me? And you have to remember that the events of this passage actually took place before the Pentecost and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. But the question is still pertinent today. Who, me? So I'm going to say this. Yes, you. You. If you tuned in here this morning to hear this message, I'm telling you that I believe God has put it on my heart that He knows that you have the potential to change the part of the world that you live in for the better. And He wants you to be a part of a world-changing movement. You see, as disciples, we've been given this wonderful gift by the Holy Spirit to fulfill the Great Commission and to make disciples for Jesus Christ. But not for the church's sake, as I've said, not in many other sermons, but for the world's sake. You know, much of our denomination focuses on making members, but you know what? It's disciples that we need to make. You know, and even though it's always best to listen, as it says in James chapter 1, it says, then when he tells us to be quick to listen and slow to speak and slow to get angry, we need to, at this particular time, to express what's going on and have the conviction of our faith to address the systemic racism that we've seen so evident now over these last few weeks and the reaction of a marginalized society. You see, but so now is not the time. Now is not the time for Christians in general and white Christians in particular to remain silent. You see, as the voices of these marginalized people have been crying out for a long time for justice. So if you think things are a mess, then I'm talking to you because you have a message. You have a message of love to share with the world. And right now, Jesus needs his disciples to do exactly what he commanded them to do. Now, some of you might doubt that I'm actually speaking to you, but that's exactly who I'm speaking to. I'm speaking to anyone listening to this message this morning. Don't doubt for a second that you don't have the potential to represent God's best interests to the world. You do. So let's live up to them. You know, I read an illustration about a concert that was given by a large college choir. It was all set to present its package in front of a church setting, and the program was of sacred song, and it was to be carried on a local radio station. With anything was ready now, the moment of production was about to occur. The announcer made his final introduction and waited for the choir director to begin. But apparently, one of the tenors was not ready. So the venerable conductor refused to raise his baton, and seconds ticked away. And the silence was uncomfortable, as nothing was being broadcast. But apparently one of the, you know, but growing nervous, the announcer said, forgetting that his microphone was on and that everyone in the church could hear this, plus those listening in on the radio station, he said in exasperation, "Get on with it, you old goat." Now earlier in the week, later on in the week, the radio station got a letter from a man who had just tuned in to that particular broadcast, and he was waiting for the concert to begin. And he was sitting in the comfort of his easy chair in the middle of his house. When he heard, "Get on with it, you old goat," he felt at that moment that God was speaking to him, that he took it personally. He had been doing nothing in his mind to further God's work in the world. And this startling message was enough to convict him to get up and start going again for God. Church, sometimes we just all need a wake-up call to be reminded that Jesus, before he left this earth, he gave us all the instructions that we need. We just have to go and make disciples for Jesus Christ. The time now is to get on with it. Let's not waste any more moments. We cry out, "Lord, revive us," because the world is waiting. And every day, we rub shoulders with people who need to accept Jesus as their personal Savior. So let's ask God to fill us with the longing to tell people, "I wish you knew my Savior's love." Then we will become instruments for peace and justice for such a time as this. The saying is, if your Christianity is worth having, it's worth sharing. Now, for 38 years, for those who've heard me enough, you know, I lived my life doubting anything I did in the world could have any significant effect. You know, and couple that with my early years when people told me I was not living up to my potential. And truthfully, I was. I was just content to, you know, get by. The way I saw it was, one day this potential would just kick in and the rest of my life would be history. Well, that all changed, church, when I met Jesus. See, I wasn't really expecting any radical change to occur when I asked Jesus Christ into my heart. And I certainly not would have envisioned where I'm standing today. And do I have self-doubts still? Yeah, for sure. But what I don't doubt is that I'm forgiven of my sins. I don't doubt that. And what I don't doubt is that my risen Savior loves me and wants me to show him, or to show the way I love him, to the way I show love to everyone I come in contact with. See, church, Jesus has called each of us because he sees the potential to do greater things than he did. And there's no doubt about that. So let's live up to it. Let's pray. God, with all the challenges that are in front of us today and the ministries and the demands and what we're in the midst of facing, help us, Lord God, to be true disciples, to be ready to impart a word of comfort and peace, support, to really, Lord God, to comfort the afflicted and to afflict the comfortable, to make disciples for the transformation of your world. And we ask all this in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
I've been waiting to tell you something. It started with the fishermen. He taught them a new way of life. He turned everything upside down to make it right side up.
Forgive 7 times? Try 70 times 7, he said. Just be nice? No. Give it all over, whatever is asked of you.
Reach over the tracks. Yeah, go to that part of town. Cling to the eternal and shake off the chains of this earth.
Sin messed everything up, the whole world, but he made it right.
Our Father, who is in heaven, holy and honored is your name. Your kingdom, it's come.
I'm pledging my life to bring it closer and closer, to show the power of your divine love, to declare deliverance from death and sin.
To all people, to each race and every language.
Making disciples of all nations, I'll own my responsibility. Go all in and make it real in my corner of the world.
The authority Jesus has already been given.
The kingdom that will come on earth as it is in heaven.
An everlasting dominion that will never pass.
Because he beat death.
Coming as the King of the Jews and finishing it all as the King of the world. His throne and authority are sovereign.
You heard right. Forgiveness without boundaries. Hope in all circumstances. And a peace that passes understanding.
Because death is conquered, eternal life is established.
That's why we keep going. Why I keep telling.
The Alpha and the Omega.
The beginning and the end.
The root.
The offspring.
The bright morning star.
Baptizing in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
From street to street.
Nation to nation.
He is the King. Power and glory belong to him.
His kingdom will have no end.
There's room for you and room for me.
Room for everyone who calls on the name of the King.
And his name is Jesus, the name above all names.
The first and last.
The one and only.
And he loves you.
And he loves you.
He loves you.
And he loves you.
And that is what I've been wanting to tell you.
name is Holly Bear, and Randy is my daddy. He told me about Pastor Tom's message this week, and how we are to tell everyone about Jesus. I had an idea, so I asked him if me and my friends could tell kids about Jesus. I just love kids, no matter how old they are. He told me we could talk to you during the kids' time in the service. So keep watching, and you just may see us in the next few weeks. Well, gotta go, and like my dad says, be safe, be kind, and be his. See ya!